Hi, my name is Joan Anderson. I was born in Seattle, Washington, February 21st, 1944, and my birth name is Joan Elizabeth Duncan. I lived in Seattle for 2 years and then grew up mostly in Montana, spent my childhood and my college years there. Then came to Nevada from Tucson, Arizona in 1985 and have been here ever since. And some of the things I've worked on since I've been in Nevada, when I first got here, my husband was with the mines, and so I met some of the other mining women, and we started a group called the Friends of the Elko Library, so I became a charter member of that. And then, shortly after that, I started working at a Head Start program, and I stayed there for 15 years. I started out as a part-time teacher. Became an education coordinator and then was director of the program for the county for 13 years. And in 2006, I resigned from that position and then started working with an architect who became my partner in business. And I'm still working on that and trying to study to become a residential designer. And so at age 70, I'm hoping that's going to be the start of my new career. Well, the story of my life began in Seattle, Washington, where I was born in February of 1944. My parents were there because of it was toward the end of the Second World War, and my dad was working at Boeing, making airplanes, and my mom was she was a teacher, so she taught at a nursery school, and my brother and I were both born in Seattle. And my dad actually didn't know it, but he was working on the Enola Gay, and many years later he found out that that was a plane that he was working on. So, and then after the war was over, in about I think it was a 45 or so, my dad got laid off, of course, from Boeing, and so we, the four of us, moved back to Montana. And my dad was from a real small town in Montana called Sheridan, and it was a beautiful little just idyllic town with, you know, beautiful houses and trees, and that's where I grew from age 2 to the 5th grade. And I went to the same school, grade school, that my grandparents went to, and that's when I became really interested in art, because there was a lot of art around, and I had a pretty talented family. And I think my mom at that point in my life was my greatest influence. You know, she taught me that I should always have a lot of energy and not to ever complain or be a hypochondriac in my life. And, you know, I just learned at a young age to have a lot of energy. And so at that time, my younger sister and brother were born, so now there were four of us kids in the family. And my mom taught school and my dad worked for the county. And after a few years, he got laid off from the county doing construction and stuff. So we moved over the hill to this small, raucous rural town. And it was so completely different from, you know, from our Sheridan town that we loved. It was, it had three streets. One of them was the main highway going right through in front of our house. And the railroad tracks going right down the middle of the road. And every day going to school, we had to cross the railroad tracks. And at that time, my dad worked at a mine, and my mom was a teacher at this small school. It was a three-room school, so each room had two or three classes in it. And so I spent from sixth to eighth grade in one classroom, in the same classroom. And when I graduated in 1958, it was a class of four kids. Oh, wow. And then there was no high school in the town we lived in, so we had to be bused to Dillon, Montana, which is about 30 miles away. So I spent the next 4 years riding a bus back and forth every day. And then when I graduated from high school, I went to Montana State University in Bozeman. And I planned on majoring in art. But then my parents decided that that might not be the most practical thing for a young girl to do, because it was the early 60s. And they said, you know, you should become a teacher, because, you know, if if nobody marries you, then you're going to have to take care of yourself, you know. So that's, so I did. I relinquished and got a degree in education. And I really loved Bozeman. It was a beautiful community. And so immediately after graduating, my ex-roommate and I went to California, you know, because we wanted to go to the big city. We got a job a few miles out of San Francisco and taught school. I taught second grade in a class of 34 kids, which was difficult. And we spent most of our time on the road exploring California and mostly San Francisco. And it was right in the middle of the 60s, you know, and so we had to go visit Haight-Ashbury, and we had to, you know, experience all what was going on in San Francisco at that time. And then after 1 year of teaching, both of us, we called ourselves, we retired from teaching after 1 year. And we went up to Lake Tahoe, worked as cocktail waitresses to earn some money so that this next year we could go to Europe. So we spent 5 months with two other friends touring all the Western countries in Europe, and went once behind the Iron Curtain, was what it was called at that time, to Budapest, and had a great time. It was a great learning experience. And that was during Vietnam War. And everywhere we went, people would ask us about the war, you know, why don't you people get out of that war? And we just kept saying, well, we're just some girls traveling around. We don't have anything to do with the war, you know. So, and we made a lot of great friends when we were over there. And so that was one of my highlights in my life, is just having that freedom to be able to travel like that with friends. And then we got back, and I spent one more year teaching in California at another school. And then I decided it was time to get my fifth year of education, and so of college education. So I went back to Melrose, a little town where I grew up, because my parents were still living there, and Dylan at that time had a college, so I went to get some classes there. Then I happened to fall in love, and never went back to California after that. I stayed in Melrose, and I got married, and I got a job teaching in the school there, in the very same school where I went to when I was younger. And my mom was a principal, so she taught first and second grade, and I taught third, fourth, and fifth grade. I had three grades in one room, and I had 15 kids. So, and that was the best experience I ever had. I stayed there 3.5 years until my son was born. But working with three different grades in one classroom was really interesting, because the older kids taught the younger ones. The younger kids actually taught some of the older ones who never picked up what they should have when they were in third grade. And the highlight of every day was story time. Every day, first thing in the morning after pledge, I'd read a story to the kids. We'd all together pick out a book, and then right after lunch, we'd read another part of the story. And that held the children, you know, together so well, because they all listening to the same story. And one time I had a problem child, and he wanted to run away because he thought the other kids were picking on him. But he had to come in after lunch and listen to the story, and then he got up and ran away. When we were living in Melrose, I had two more children, two daughters. So we had three children, and then decided to move down to Tucson, where the mining was good, and that my husband got a job there. And we spent 6 years there. And then when the mining kind of went down, the copper mining went down in Tucson area, then my husband got a job in Elko, Nevada, one of the gold mines. So then we moved. We weren't exactly happy about moving to a small town in the desert, but when we got here, and after we were here for a while, we found out that it was a great place to live. My children had so many more opportunities here than they had in a bigger place, and they got involved in science fairs and music. They were all playing music in the bands and getting better grades, and then eventually getting scholarships and everything. So it was a real advantage for us to have them move here, and it was a safer place. Mm-hmm. And so then I started getting involved with the community a little bit. And so I met a group of friends who were also mining wives who weren't working. And we formed a group called the Friends of the Elko Library, Elko County Library, where we did a lot of fundraising to help pay for books for the library and to have them provide programs for the community. And so we started with a fundraiser called Just Desserts, and it's still going on today after all these years, so we're proud of that. And then when my kids got older, I took a leave of absence from teaching for like 18 years or something like that, and I finally decided, well, I should go back to work doing something. Mm-hmm. So I got a job at Head Start. There was a small Head Start program here in Elko, and it's a federal program that was for the whole county of Elko. And so I started out as a part-time teacher, working just a few hours a day, and then for about 5 months, and then I became the education coordinator for the program, was kind of coordinating training for teachers and organizing them. And then after 3 years, I became the director of the program, and I was director of the program for 13 years. And during that time, I really feel like this is probably one of the highlights in Elko is I took that program from 51 children to, when I left, there were 150 children enrolled in the program. And we had locations in Jackpot and Wells, and for a short time in Carlin, and then mostly here in Elko. And I started working with actually the architect that I'm apprenticing with right now on designing a lot of the buildings for the program. So I got a real interest in architecture at that time. And then we were able to get some funding for an infant toddler program, which they called Early Head Start. And so we built two new buildings to house those children. And we got, I increased the staff from like 12 to, when I left, it was 50 people that were on the payroll. And so that provided quite a few jobs for the community. And during that time, we worked for teacher certification because most of the mm-hmm. teachers had no education whatsoever. So we were able to get classes funded for them to get like their AA degrees and things in early childhood. And then we also started a respite program where the children, the parents of children with disabilities got a break, like on a Saturday. We had people come in and take care of those children on like a Saturday so the parents could go shopping or catch a movie or go to dinner, whatever they wanted to, which they a lot of times don't. They have a hard time finding babysitters, you know, for children who are involved. And then another program we had was a wraparound, we called it. It was funded by the state, and it extended the day for parents who worked more hours in the day than what the program was like from 9 till 4, and a lot of parents worked later hours, so we were able to give them those kind of services too. And during the time I was at Head Start, I had two wonderful experiences for myself. I attended a child care design institute in Boston at Harvard and Tufts for a week, and worked child care professionals and architects worked together for a whole week to learn from each other, you know, what child care professionals need out of architects when they're designing their programs and their facilities. And then the child care people learn from the architects how they work. And so it was a wonderful experience. And we had a child psychologist from California that was leading the program. So it was a lot about psychology too. And that the other place I attended was at UCLA. I went to a Johnson & Johnson Fellows Program, and it was funded part by Head Start and part by the Johnson & Johnson Company. And it was a management program for 2 weeks. where you learned intensive management strategies. So those two were, you know, real highlights of my life too. And then, meanwhile, while I was still working at Head Start, I started working with a partner, the architect downtown. He had a building downtown that was an old, it was a dive bar, and so we decided that we should have something better in Elko, you know, because there's already enough of those. So we closed the place down and started remodeling it, tore the whole front off the building, remodeled the inside, and turned it into a nice little wine bar and a contemporary art gallery. So, and we're still, that's our business today. And then there was an old rooming house upstairs, so we turned that into like a little European inn. And so we have guests stay up there. And it's been a really good experience for, I think for our community, because a lot of people are now kind of trying to renovate their places and getting a little more different kind of businesses in there. Mm-hmm. Our little wine bar is a very comfortable place for women to hang out. And, you know, it's not raucous and not smoke-filled, and it's, you know, and you get to grab a glass of wine and go look at the artwork. Mm-hmm. So, and my daughter joined us as a partner, too, recently, and she manages the wine bar, and she also has taken charge of getting bands in from out of the area. Mm-hmm. And so we have a lot of live music for the locals, and it's our way to kind of promote young musicians. And we've met so many wonderful musicians that are on tour around the country. You know, I think Elko is a really good place for me to be because I've been able to use my creativity to help build a passive peace park with a group of people. And also, as a member of the Art and Culture Advisory Board, you know, we get to work on a lot of projects that are art-related, trying to bring a lot more cultural activities into the community, and also advising the city council on how they should be promoting arts and culture in our community. Mm-hmm. And I think, I never think of myself as a leader, but more like a collaborator with other people. I think that's important. And I guess my driving force in this community is the passion for the arts, that's why we opened the Duncan Little Creek Gallery. And we call it the Gallery and the Gallery Bar. And I'd like to be remembered in this community as someone who cares about the community. And my advice to especially to young women is to, I just say, just go for it. You know, if you're talented and you have a lot of gifts, you should just use them and to your best advantage and to the advantage of the community, and don't hide them under a basket. Mm-hmm.